Okay,
Hello.
we're live.
Okay, hi everybody. Welcome to On the Couch Sessions this week with Julie Zommers from Truly Madly Deeply and Alison from Happy Soul. Now, today we thought we'd talk about what stops EFT from working. So there can be many things, and we've kind of touched on them already, but once again, we want to clarify this for you because it's really important, because often what can happen is you can start doing EFT on yourself and you think it's just not working and then you give up. So we thought we'd discuss a few of the key areas about how you can overcome that and some tips and tricks on what to do to get better results. Yeah, so anything you wanted to add to that, Julie, before we begin?
No, far away.
Okay, so firstly, I hope you viewers can hear me because I'm actually in my hubby's office today, so I'm talking quietly. So you might have to turn up your volume. Okay, so when we are working on ourselves, for example, and you know you're working on, say, a pain in your head, so you've got a headache, and you're starting off, you know, you're tapping the side of the hand, and you're saying, even though I've got this headache, and I love and accept myself anyway, and then you're going around the point saying that you've got a headache, but you're not getting any results. So there can be a few things going on here. One of the most important things to remember, if you're not getting results, is be more specific with what the problem is. So that's where it's really good to use the side of the hand. And remember, we don't always have to do this, but for the purpose of today, we're going to show you using the hand again, because one, it sets you up, and two, it counteracts any problems that you might have about not getting results, which is kind of what we're talking about. So, for example, it could be you're not being specific enough. So instead of just saying, I've got this headache, you would be saying, I've got this dull throbbing headache, and say exactly where it is, which is at the front of your head. This gets your energy system more prepared and hooks you in more to what's actually really going on. That's your setup statement. You can say that a couple of times. And then remember, around the points, you'd be saying again what the problem is for this dull headache. And then you might be saying, it's at the front of my head. This dull headache is at the front of my head. And then you might also remember that there might be a lot of frustration with that headache. So you can throw in as well, really frustrated at that headache. So just trying to be specific, being on target, we call it sometimes, just really getting in tune with what it is and then tapping around the points. And you might find also, so doing a couple of rounds at least and then a big breath in and letting it go and just check in with the headache. This is actually a really important one, Julie, to touch on as well, is personally when I work on a pain and specifically a headache, for me, I find that the headache doesn't immediately go away. It can be about 5 minutes later. So don't give up and just think, well, it's not working. Just allow yourself a bit of integration time. I find that's pretty much always the case when I'm working with a pain for myself, with a headache specifically. What about you, Julie? How do you find the same when you're working with a headache?
Yes, look, sometimes I feel that it's good to tune into the feeling or the emotion.
Yeah.
So once you've tapped the actual physical aspect, even though I have this headache in the right-hand side of my eye and it feels like a stabbing feeling, but then I say, this headache makes me feel, you know, if I'm trying to come in from different angles, this headache makes me feel, and it might be frustrated because I can't get on with my work. This headache makes me feel hopeless because I'm getting them once a week and I don't know why and I can't fix it. So tuning into the feeling really gets you into your body. And you know, sometimes I find if I'm working with a client and I can't get in there just through the physical aspect, I get into the feeling. Like, I'm really frustrated by this headache. Why doesn't everybody else get headaches? Why is it me? And it's interesting because then that can lead to a whole lot of other stuff, you know.
Yes, definitely. The intertwining of the relationship between the pain or the relationship that you have with the issue, it's a really important one, isn't it? And that can, again, be another setup statement. Or you can just keep going around, like you were saying, organically, and just going around with actually the pain at one point and then the next point saying, like you said, this frustration with this pain, you know, why do I always seem to have it? It's all about me, you know. And then you've got a whole different gamut of issues there in themselves, haven't you? Which can be getting really to the root cause as well of always feeling like you're going to get them and different, I suppose, payoffs for having them, if you like.
And I think the whole point of it is that if you look at the basic premise that we're self-healing machines, but what gets in the way of the healing is the stress. So once you've just peeled off those layers and got rid of, you know, this hurts, you know, this headache's hurting or this knee's hurting or whatever, and then any underlying feelings, no matter what happens, whether the headache goes straight away or doesn't go or whatever, I mean, it usually does, but just that relaxation is not going to create any harm. It can only do good. So it's so worth doing. I actually successfully managed to stop a migraine the other day.
Oh, and wow.
Even though I've been a tapper for over a decade now, but even so, I've never been game enough, because I know what happens if it goes into full blown. Even I've never been game enough to just do tapping, which sounds ridiculous, but I always take the medication. Okay. And this time I thought, you know what? You've got to walk your talk, girl. You are not taking your medication. You're just going to tap. And I tapped, and it took 15 minutes, and I had my eyes closed, and my head was pounding, and my vision was all fractured and weird.
Oh, I get the same.
And it went away. And I was so rapt, because now I know for absolute certain that you can tap away migraines, and every migraine's different. But in this case, it worked brilliantly. And I'm not going to reach for my medication. You know how usually you're in a panic, because if you don't take your medication straight away, it's just terrible. So that's mine.
That's fantastic. That's a real accomplishment. I'm with you on that one as well, Julie, because since I was about 17, I also had that type of migraine where the vision goes funny and it's like everything's chopped up and you can't see, you can't function. So I too did the same, which was funny, as I also used to go straight for the Panadol, and exactly the same scenario about a year ago. I thought, what am I doing? I need to try tapping on this. Crazy. And it also worked. And again, like you said, the really important thing here for the listeners is it's also about the emotions around it and the stress in the body, and then you create more stress and panic about not being able to function, not being able to see, feeling sick. That's obviously inhibiting the body from naturally healing itself. So it's a really good point. Like, just calming the nervous system down, as we know, will put your body in a better position to heal. But remember, sometimes it can take a little bit of time, 15 minutes, 20 minutes to integrate. Some other points there, just while I'm thinking at the moment about the impediments, the other thing which we sort of touched about was the belief about it. Was a really, really important one, isn't it? So if you've got this racket in your head going on about, I don't believe that this is going to go away because normally I have to take paracetamol, or I don't believe that this is going to budge because normally it gets stuck in for the whole day, that's another setup statement in itself. And by doing it on the side of the hand, remember, we're counteracting that, what we call psychological reversal, which is basically you've got the batteries in the wrong way around. So remember, if you're not getting results, guys, go back to another setup statement on the side of your hand saying more specifically what it is, and that you love and accept yourself and that you're okay anyway, or adapting the words to yourself. Because either you're not on target or you're not specific enough, or there's some belief about it not moving, or there's some payoff for keeping it. This is the thing we've touched on previously, and it's really important to keep reminding people of that, because that's often where people aren't getting results, is just not on target. They're not really hitting the mark with what the issue's about.
I think there's a core belief in people too. That was great, Ali, what you just said. The core belief in people that they've learned and they've also been told, and that is, when you've got this, you're going to have it for this length of time and you're not going to get rid of it easily. And so that's a belief that's really running the show. And when you've got that belief, it's just like, well, that's what's going to happen, you know. And certainly tapping can unlock that. But what I'm saying is, you know, sometimes when you go to the fire walking, for instance, and someone says, you know, you'll walk over coals and you won't burn your feet. And you go, yeah, right.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, never doing that. And have you done that?
Yeah, I have done that.
That's amazing. Did you get bad feet?
No. I didn't. And
I haven't done it yet. But you know, so you had a core belief, if I walk over those coals, I'm going to get burnt feet. But somebody told you, whether it was Tony Robbins or whoever it was that you went to, somebody told you that if you do this, therefore that will happen. And you bought into that belief. You must have, because you didn't burn your feet. And it's kind of, what I'm trying to say is, they're just thoughts, they're just beliefs. And a lot of them can be changed. You know, it's like in the old days, it was like, if you have anxiety, it can't be really cured. You're going to be stuck with this for life. And it's just, it's a non-truth.
Yes, I totally agree. And I think this is...
cure anxiety, end of story. You can get rid of it. Actually, I just watched a really good program last night, Insight, on SBS. And they were talking exactly about that. And I thought, wow, in the 1970s when I had anxiety, it was just like, no. You're just going to be stuck with this, and it's really going to intrude on your life. So you better get used to it, kind of. And I'm just living proof that that's not true. It's just not true.
Yeah.
So.
I think it's important. And like I remember when I was told that I had really bad arthritis. You know, I was told by the specialist that, you know, I will be in a wheelchair by this stage, and, you know, they'll have to do this operation, and, you know, have to take medication for the rest of your life, and rah-de-rah-de-rah. And I remember working on this later in life, using tapping on the memory of the specialist, the person in authority, telling me that's the way it's going to be. So when I went into the memory and changed that, and, you know, worked on the feelings and the beliefs around it, you know, I believe that also supported me to continue my journey of healing. But it's really, really key, isn't it? The things we take on from society, from magazines, from friends, from family. You know, you've got people living in an environment where it's completely hammered home to them that, oh, this is just the way it's going to be for you. You're the one in the family that just behaves this way, and maybe you're just going to have to accept it. But actually, what we're saying with EFT is, we love and accept ourselves, even though we've got this problem, and that we're willing to let it go and change it. It's very, very empowering.
Yeah, and to get back to the headache thing, and I know a lot of people will disagree with this, but I think it's really great to ask yourself, your inner self, like, I wonder why I've got this headache. You know, I wonder why I've got this headache. I wonder if I need to slow down. I wonder if that's the message I'm being given. You know, and some people say, oh, that's crap. You know, I mean, it's just a physical thing. My belief is, yes, perhaps it might be, but from my experience as a practitioner, you know, 99% of the time it's something underneath it that is going to create that. Like, how many times do people get sick when they're going out of their comfort zone? So we're getting off topic a little bit here, but, you know, it's the same premise, you know. If it comes from you to give you a message without sounding too woo-woo, then it's really good to just maybe have a bit of an examination of, I wonder why I've got that. Well, you know, why have I developed laryngitis when I have to go on stage and speak and I'm terrified of public speaking? You know? Okay, thanks for trying to help me out, laryngitis, but, you know, I'm going to be fine. I don't need you. I'm releasing you from my body. Yeah, that's an extreme example, but do you agree with that, Al?
I do. I really do, and I think this is where EFT can be really, really creative. And it is taking that step away from yourself almost and going, okay, so instead of just almost accepting that this is my lot, that I get headaches at a certain time of the month, for example, if you're a woman, you know, women have this thing going on, or with the menopause, you know, I also started to experience those symptoms for myself. And I started to work on all the feelings around the menopause, for example, you know, about the fear that's out there about, oh, you're going to be this, you're going to be that, blah, blah, blah. And actually, you know, working on those fears and those beliefs that are put out there in the Western world about the menopause, for example, I have a totally different viewpoint on it now, and I'm kind of embracing this whole new part of my life. So I think it's opportunities, aren't they, to go, even though at the time, I don't want an opportunity when I've got a really bad headache, but actually it's a very good point to say, why have I got these continued headaches? Most of the time it's stress, but let's also just touch on this if we can for a minute. Some other impediments to getting good results, for example, is not drinking enough water. Dehydration is one of the top five, I think, reasons why people don't shift, because they're just not hydrating the bodies enough to let stuff go. So the energy is getting stuck in the body and the chemicals. So that's another one. The chemical chemical interference and environment is really, really important. So if you're working on an issue on yourself, for example, about not being heard, and you know, you're working on these feelings and you've got this little conversation, you're tapping around the points, but yet your environment is constantly negative and that you've got people around you who are just basically not respecting you and not listening to you, that's also possibly going to impede, because it's about looking holistically, isn't it, about who you live with, what thoughts you're thinking, what clothes you wear, all those things are going to help release whatever it is, and it might be the core issue that you can get to then when you do that. So the other thing with that is with the chemicals as well. Sometimes if your body is very toxic, whether that be because of alcohol or drugs or certain medications, sometimes, not all the time, sometimes that can also inhibit the results. And this is quite an interesting one, because I work with quite a lot of people who, some women who are on antidepressants, and I used to myself have the belief as a practitioner that actually it's going to be harder. But I've soon realized that, having worked successfully with women who are on antidepressants, that actually it's not true at all. And of course, sometimes the feelings are masked slightly when the medication's there. And so that emotional state you can't get as strongly to be able to let go of the issue. However, it still works. It still is somehow preparing the mind and the body to potentially start withdrawing, with guidance from a GP, from those medications. So yes, I do believe that chemicals can play a role with body that's highly toxic, possibly maybe a little too acidic, but I don't get hooked on that too much, Julia, because I think we can get over analytical. But I certainly think that, you know, water, looking at the body chemistry, your vitality, the people in your environment, all those things can sometimes inhibit the results. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, I mean, it's all about energy, and I think that, you know, flow of energy, like, it's like a muddy old sluggish river. You know, it hasn't got fresh water in it, and if it hasn't got something moving it along. And I think, you know, toxic people can drag you down, toxic everything that you just discussed can get in the way. Sometimes I find, you know, I usually ask clients not to wear really heavy perfume to a session. You know, I've had sessions with, because I work globally. Oh, that sounds so, you know, important, doesn't it? But because I work with people overseas, let's put it like that.
Yeah, globally.
Sometimes it's their evening and my early morning. And, you know, just once or twice I've had the experience that obviously wine or some alcohol has been consumed. And it really mars the process, you know. And I actually have to say something in that situation now, like, next time, you know, hold back until after the call. But sometimes it's 9 o'clock at night and people come home and they have a little cocktail or whatever, and that's fine. No judgment there, but I just find it alters the nature of the session. I can't connect as much, you know. I can't connect with that person when that's happening. I think
there's a certain amount as well.
I think that's why it's really important that, you know, both you and I are really big on a really safe, nurturing environment for people, just to get that softness. So if there is a whole lot of stuff out there that's happening and they're being abused or they're not being listened to or heard or, you know, they're lacking love, basically, it's really good to just, that will set them well on the way. I don't want anyone to misconstrue what we said about, you know, if you've got negative people in your life, that can mar your healing. Mar your healing while you're there. You know, like, it, once they come into our environment, if you know what I mean, because you've got a whole bunch of toxic people in your life, doesn't mean that you can't heal. Do you understand
what I mean? No, not at all. I don't want anyone to understand that.
You know, you can heal. But if you're in a room full of negative people and somebody says, hey, have you tried this tapping? And it's sort of like this half-hearted thing, that's not going to work, probably.
Yes. Yes, so I'm thinking of some other simple sort of tips that we can give our viewers about EFT not working. I've just, while you were talking there, I was just thinking about the safety aspect again, which we've touched on before. It's such an important one. Sometimes you really do need to work with a practitioner if you're not getting the results, maybe because you're not getting to the core issue, possibly because you're getting lost in what you're working on, but also there's not the safety aspect there, like you said. So working with a practitioner who's skilled at being able to create that environment so that you can safely start to explore what it's really all about, i.e. the I'm not worthy, I'm not heard, you know, I'm not good enough, it's always I'm trapped, all those feelings, the results can be inhibited, I suppose, by you not being skilled enough on your own. Sometimes you can just get lost and you can tap around the points and say all these fun words and that will help, but maybe not getting right to the core. So two things with safety, I suppose. One is using the setup statement again about, you know, even though, you know, for example, I'll give you an example, it's easier. So even though sometimes I don't feel heard, I'm getting lost here, sorry, I'm just trying to think of something. So even though I don't feel safe letting this one go, for example, because last time I did, this happened. I love and accept myself anyway. So even though I don't feel safe letting this one go, because last time I spoke out, they shouted at me, for example. I love and accept myself anyway. You might not be able to come to that conclusion of what that's about on your own. So working with somebody else who can guide you, plus create that safe space for you to start unraveling what it's all about. And, you know, there might be tears, there might be upset, but when you do that on your own and there's tears and upset, sometimes what can happen with people in the beginning is they kind of just go, oh dear, that's all a bit too much, and then just walk off and leave themselves kind of exposed. Do you see, yeah. You know what I mean, don't you, Julie? And I think really when you're not getting results, it can be all the things we've already talked about, but it also just might be the simple thing of going, I'm going to invest some time in somebody else who knows how to guide me through a process so I can get results. And that might be really brilliant, because then you get right bang to the core issue and have this amazing revelation that actually, I am okay, you know, and I couldn't have got to that place on my own. So it was a bit of a ramble there, and I hope I got there in the end.
Oh, no, it was fabulous. It was really great. Look, The more that I see clients, the more that I think everybody should start there. It sounds like I'm drumming up, you know, come, we need the business. No, but I'm not. But because I see people just get through stuff so quickly.
Yes.
And also, I think what happens if you do it on your own, look, I think it's fantastic to tap on your own, and I'm totally encouraging. But if you've got something you're really stuck with and you haven't been able to budge, I think one of the big reasons too, getting back to the original thing of why tapping doesn't work sometimes, is because the inside of your mind, your subconscious has been running the show for however old you are, for, in my case, 60 years. And, you know, only about 5% of us during the day makes any original decisions. The other 95% are already made for us, kind of thing. And so if you're trying to tap on your own on an issue that you've been hanging on to forever, your ego mind is bound to say, nah, I don't think you go there. Whereas when you're with a therapist, you tend to go, okay, let's just explore that a little bit. But you're in a really safe environment. And if somebody says, you know, I don't really want to go there, I'll say, okay, well, let's look at something that was happening around that time. And we've got our nifty little ways of gradually getting in there, but comfortably. Whereas if you're at home tapping on an issue that's really important to you, you're probably going to find 100 excuses not to do it. It's not you personally, you here today. It's the back of your mind that wants to keep you safe. Oh, I don't think we'll go there. Oh, I wonder what's in the fridge. Maybe I'll go and have something to eat. Maybe I'll have a nice hot cup of tea and do a bit of tapping later. I better open this can of worms. Maybe I just better get on with it, you know. So all of this, these little tricks at the back of our mind plays.
Yes, yeah. You said that absolutely brilliantly. That's just spot on. It's like, and how many times do we do that? You know, I've done that myself the last few days. Oh. I've had a busy schedule. I'm like, oh, I'll just go and hang the washing out, and then I'm just like, oh my goodness, I've got an hour left to prepare this whole big thing. So yes, sometimes you need to be in company with somebody else, don't you?
It must be something in the air. because yesterday, because I had to write this important thing, and so I went and polished my piano, which I hadn't done for like 5 years, and I thought, oh no, it needs a jolly good polish. And I'm the same as you. The art of procrastinating, and it all comes from that wily little part of us that says, oh, no.
Funny.
It all comes from, like, well, the article that I've got to write might not be very good, you know, so why don't I go and polish the old piano instead?
Yeah, because ultimately what we're doing often, isn't it, is avoiding some kind of judgment or pain. That's ultimately, when we really narrow it down to something, why do we procrastinate? Why do we put things off? It's because we think we're going to fail at them, or it's going to be too hard. I know that's a whole new topic.
Sorry, Ellie, before you go, because I know you've got to go in like 4 minutes. But I just wanted to say that is another reason why tapping doesn't work sometimes. Yeah. Because even though you say you want to get rid of a problem, you don't know who you'd be without it. Like, somehow it's defined you. And so you can't let go of something that you're holding on to so tightly. And, you know, I think I said that last week too, but it's such a good metaphor. You know, you don't want to hold on to it, but something inside of you just can't let it go. For example, if you've been molested as a child and you hate the bastard, you know, you think, how dare they? I've got it, and we touched on this last week. Sorry about the swearing, guys. But you're holding on your pain. You think, I'll show them how they've ruined my life. If I'm happy, then they've got away with it. And so all that, it could be all sorts of different things. It doesn't just have to be about that sort of thing. It could be a whole lot of things. Like, you might be consistently sick since you were a kid. And to suddenly be well, you're not going to get as much. Your life's going to be different.
Yeah.
It's going to give you a whole lot of new things to handle. So even though you don't do it on a conscious level, I'm not accusing or suggesting for one moment that anyone's holding on to something in their, you know, with their logical mind to get attention or anything, but it's your subconscious that does that.
Yes. Couldn't agree more. Yeah.
And therefore, you're going to have to sort of use a few crowbar techniques for us to sort of dig in and, you know, get rid of them.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like you said so eloquently the other week about, it's like you're just weeding the garden of all these beliefs that you've got about healing, whether that's emotional or physical. You, like you say, who will I be without it? Will I be this? I don't want to suddenly become this arrogant, confident person. You know, I'm normally quite shy and gentle. But that's very real, isn't it, for some people? It's like, because I work with a lot of people who have obviously got low confidence. I say obviously, most people do. Most of us. All of us do at some point in our lives, but there might be a fear that if I step into this new confident me, people won't like me anymore and they'll think I'm cocky, you know. And I often say to people, when you do use tapping, it's quite sometimes it can be a massively powerful experience and you're like, wow, but quite often it's more of a subtle, beautiful, peaceful change, isn't it? It's like this sudden blossoming of you that's been smothered for a while, and then by that happening, it allows all sorts of areas of your body to heal and other amazing possibilities start showing up. Just one last thing I was going to say before we wrap up, if that's okay. I've just been thinking, I don't know whether we touched on it, but another key thing with when EFT is not working is simply, and this is hard, and this is a tappable issue in itself, because people can't be bothered these days, you know, all of us are, so, you know, we've got a lot on our plate, is that persistence is needed. Sometimes you need to do something for several days, like 21 days. You know, sometimes we need to do that 21-day break in the habit. Or it might just be, I say to a lot of my clients in between sessions, every morning I'm going to invite you to do this little tapping thing to set your day up, to start changing the energy in the body and changing the belief systems, but do it every day. It's like Joe Dispenza, isn't it? It's, you know, change your mind, change your world, you know, and that's really key sometimes, is to keep being persistent, but also find a check-in buddy so that you're not left alone trying to do it by yourself, whether that's a practitioner or a friend. Hooking in with somebody else and going, look, I need a bit of help here. I've got something really stuck. I'm supposed to be, or I've been asked to do this tapping every day, but I'm struggling. Can you be my little action person, or can you check in with me? And I find that helps people a lot. Yeah.
That's great. And at the very least, just tapping, everyday healing. just healing every day. I'm healing what I do, healing every day. You know, and that's sort of a cheat one. But it's bigger than nothing. If I can't do that one, and I was talking to this client in London the other day, and she said, but how will I, don't I have to say all the words about where the healing can go? And I said, look, if you're in a hurry and you wake up and you just want something to tune up your energy system, just go healing, trusting that healing knows where to go. I'm healing, I'm trusting it, healing, I'm sending healing to any part of my body. And, you know, I'm not going against what you said about being specific. I'm saying about these really quick taps.
Oh, no, it's both. It's both. It's like life, isn't it? There's an ebb and the flow, and there's the black and the white, and there's no given set way. We're just giving the viewers and the listeners some tidbits that we know work, which is, yes, sometimes you need to be on target when you want to try and get to the real root cause. And sometimes, like you say, you just, if you're going to tap and it means you just do a quick tap, brilliant. If you're not going to tap because you don't know what to say, that's no good, is it? So it's like you say, it's very important just to start doing it. Start tapping around the points and having a play. And that might be all that's needed, just for 21 days or for a week.
And and fast is good. Like, one more minute.
That's okay.
Yeah. Yesterday, I don't know what happened, but just right out of the blue, I really missed my mum. And it was so acute. I felt really overwhelmed. I was in my own lounge room. I think I was a bit stressed yesterday, probably because of all the polishing of the piano. Anyways, I just felt really, I was really happy, but I was constantly sort of stressing yesterday, too many things to do, not enough time to do it. And I think I cast my eye across to this painting I've got on the wall of her, and it just was like immediate. I just started crying. What I'm saying to people is, it doesn't mean that you're going to block all your feelings when you do a quick tap. I wanted to be sad. I miss my mum, you know. Yes. But I just went, all this grief. Oh, God, how I miss her. Oh, she was so much fun. I just miss her so much. I love her, and I love that she was my mum. And, you know, it was 5 minutes, and I felt this peace and calm. It was really beautiful, Ali. And then I felt really grateful for having tapping, and I thought, my God, if I didn't have this, I probably would have felt like just really grieved all day. I would have had this real heaviness.
Yeah.
But it just went. It was just love. It was just felt like love. I just felt like, it's okay to cry, darling. Like, I was really soft on myself suddenly, whereas, when it first happened, it was like, and I felt all of my whole body, like, really, really upset. And within 5 minutes, just, yes, my mum. It's okay.
Yeah. Beautiful. Thanks for sharing. That's a beautiful illustration of the quick tap again and just being creative. Yeah.
Well, we'll see each other next week. And in the meantime, somewhere between now and then, we'll nut out what to talk about. We should maybe talk about Joe Dispenza 1 week.
Yeah, but we can do that.
That would probably require reading the book and taking a whole lot of notes and being really sensible. I don't know if I've got the time at the moment. But we'll sort out next week for you guys. So it's bye from me.
And it's bye from me. The two Ronnies.
Thank you. I know, we're waiting for our punchline at the end. Well, bye-bye for now is my favourite.
Oh.
Okay, darling. Well, it's Julie Zommers, trulymadlydeeplyhappy.com, and Ali Monaghan, happysoul.com, happy with an I. Very sexy. Okay, Ali, have a great day, honey.
Thank you, and you too.